I, you know, it's different because I played two different characters. I have different thoughts about each one of them. I mean, for Rocket, my favorite scene to do in a lot of ways was the 12% of a plan scene in the first movie, because that was when it was pretty early. It was like in the middle of shooting, and I think it's when we realized really what the movie was and what it was supposed to feel like and what it was about. And it was the first time that I think it all came into focus a little bit for me. But you know, as an actor, I think that the stuff at the end of Guardians 2, as Kraglin, both seeing the Ravager funeral, cheering for it, and then sort of the just after that when Quill gives Kraglin the arrow, is that's my favorite stuff sort of overall, because it reminds me of things to come.
All right.
Perfect, thank you. Now, before we jump over here, I have a question for you, Sean. Of course, Guardians of the Galaxy, a major part of the MCU, but you know, from a comic book fan's perspective, if I think back to it correctly, there were some thoughts before the first movie came out of who are the Guardians of the Galaxy, you know, at the time, you know, Captain America, Iron Man, per se, bigger names in the Marvel comics. But when Guardians of the Galaxy came out, people loved it, and now it's a huge part of the cinematic universe. Was there a time when preparing for or filming the first movie when you and the team realized, oh, we have something really special here?
From my understanding, it was really when they went, you know, they had been shooting for 11 days, and I didn't go on this trip, but my brother and the main cast went down to San Diego Comic-Con and showed just a really brief sizzle reel from stuff they'd been only shooting for a few days, and had cut together on the, you know, on the fly, and the audience just went bananas for it. Like, they lost their mind, and it was like, and I know that they came back from that trip being like, guys, I think we're making a movie that could be like a hit movie right now. So I think that was kind of when things started to steamroll a little bit.
That's awesome. Thank you.
Yeah.
Over here, your name and your question.
Hi, Sean. My name is Cher. And my question is, who is the biggest practical joker on set? And did you get it on film?
Well, you know, there's a difference between a practical joker and just a regular joker. Practical joker usually means some kind of prop or something like that. And you couldn't get away with doing that on a movie set. Like, we're actors, but we're also professionals at work working. And so people don't really tend to try to mess with other people's work. But jokes and just joking around, that happens nonstop. And the biggest jokers are Chris Pratt and my brother, James. But everybody kind of a little bit. It's a pretty funny cast.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hello.
Hi, I'm Matt. I was wondering, what was the process like to be hired as an animated space raccoon?
Good question. So basically before, when my brother got hired to direct the movie, I think his biggest fear, I know his biggest fear, and he talked about it with his team, was that Rocket would just look stupid, basically. That it's like, you know, it's a, you know, it's a short walk from Rocket looking really cool to, you know, apologies to Jar Jar Binks seeing him, so that it just doesn't, no offense to anybody, but that technology looked, it's like it was used too early, is the point I'm trying to make. So he knew that was going to be really tricky. So he didn't want, they hadn't cast that actor to do the voice yet, and he didn't want a tennis ball on a stick or an AD just reading lines off stage, because he wanted the cast to be able to interact with them. And he and I had worked together so much that he asked me to do it. He said, I want you to come and do Rocket, but I don't know how we're going to do it. I just know that we're going to, you know, you'll read him in the read through, and then if you could read his line, we don't know if you'll be just off camera or what. So we did the read through, and then we did the first rehearsal, and I just got down on my hands and knees and started playing Rocket down from the ground. I had gone to acting school, and I like studied how to mimic animals and animal behavior and stuff like that, which is crazy to think that I would ever use that then in my career. But I started to realize that as weird as it looked, other people get over the weirdness real quick. So the other actors, it's like weird for a little bit, but it's like, oh wow, that's crazy. And then they forget about it, and they just started to treat me like an actor. And they're looking, when they look down to where Rocket is, there's a set of human eyes there looking at them. And that's what really works. So we started doing that on set. Then the visual effects team, after about a week or so of this, they went to my brother and they said, this is really helpful for us, because as we're starting to try to animate this character and make him realistic, we have a reference point. We know where his eyes are moving, what his hands are doing, and all this kind of thing. So then they started to really be like, we're going to shoot you as a reference as pretty much everywhere where Rocket is, and then use it as needed. It's different from traditional motion capture, because I'm not wearing balls and lights and numbers and all that stuff, because they're not doing it digitally. They're just watching my performance and translating it. So that's a long answer, but that's what happened.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Very fascinating.
Hi, my name is Ray, and I was wondering, if you were the leader of the Guardians, what role would you pursue for them to follow?
If I was leader of the Guardians, well, I think the Guardians are doing it right? I mean, they're out there standing up for the little guy and fighting the oppressors of the universe. I don't know that I would. I don't think I'd change it up at all.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Hello.
My name is Kyan, and I would like to ask, what's your favorite video game?
Oh boy. Pitfall?
Again, the right answer for someone wearing.
Can you tell I'm not a gamer? Sadly, yeah.
Have you provided any voices for any of the Marvel?
No, I did a voice for a video game called Lollipop Chainsaw.
Oh, that's
brother made years ago.
Yeah.
That's the only time I've ever done a video game. And I am, I really am not much of a gamer anymore. I used to have, you know, I back in the day. But what's your favorite video game?
I like Half-Life 2.
Sweet. I've heard good things. I'll have to pick that up one of these decades.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Hello.
Hi, Sean. My name's Sarah, and I'm obviously a big fan of Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah.
It's like one of my favorite movies, both 1 and 2, and you're awesome with both characters. It's a really pleasure meeting you. So I'm really wondering how physical of a job it was being Rocket the Raccoon, because he has a lot of scenes where he's doing a lot of physical things, and if there was ever a time where when you were playing the character it was really difficult physically for you to do something.
Yes, that's a good question, and it is very physically demanding, because I'm in a squat and I'm often walking from the squat position, which is everyone watching it always says it must be hard on your knees, but for whatever reason, my knees were never the problem, but my ankles and my feet were taxed a great deal. And then whenever there were shots that were long walks, which I know some of the video got out from the Avengers movie when we did a long walk, and like that day was kind of murder, but it was, I'm just, for whatever reason, I'm a very limber person. And I just have to stay in shape and make sure that I like do my exercises and keep my feet stretched and my legs stretched, and And it's tricky, and I will say that particularly on this last movie, this most recent movie, I'm feeling my age a little bit, you know? Like, I'm 48 years old, and it's like, I don't, see the movie, but I think my years of squatting as Rocket are probably behind me.
Thank you so much.
Do you yoga? Do you, you know?
I do sometimes a little bit, but I do a variety of
stretches.
Yeah.
Awesome. Over here.
Hi, I'm Alex. Who do you think your favorite director you've ever worked with is?
I see a number of cameras on right now.
Have you ever seen Pearl Harbor, directed by Michael Bay? Because I play the traction sailor, and that was just, no, of course it's my brother. I really do, you know, I get the question a lot, and the sort of, I think that the lame answer, but the true answer is that I love working with my brother. We work together really well. Our jobs fit, you know, he's a creator and I'm an actor, and so, like, we have a shorthand for talking to each other, and it's really very, very simple. He's my older brother anyway, so the idea of him being in charge, and I'm the youngest of six, so it's not like it's like, I'm not like walking around pouting because my brother's in charge. It's sort of like something that's already ingrained in me, and I love working with him, so he will always be the answer to that question. But I've been fortunate to work with a lot of really good directors, and there's hopefully more coming too. Thanks.
Thank you.
Great question. Now, before we move on to this one, I'm curious, for yourself and your brother, and I believe that you also have other siblings who have or are currently in the entertainment industry as well.
Yes.
For yourselves, you know, was there a moment when you were growing up together, where you were all like, you know, or yourself and James, where you were like, I want to be an actor, I want to be a screenwriter, I want to be a director. Was there, like, what was the inspiration, or was there a light bulb moment?
No, it was, we really all came at it from different angles. We all went off and performed. I'm the youngest of six, I have four brothers. All four of my brothers are in the entertainment industry. And we're from the suburbs of St. Louis, so it's very strange. My sister's an attorney, but we really all kind of followed our own paths, and then ended up landing back in the world of entertainment. And it was I wanted to be an actor since I've had a memory. I wanted to be an actor when I was 4 years old. Said, what do you want to do when you grow up? I would say I wanted to be an actor. So that's always been very much a part of me. And my other, James was always doing tons of creative projects. He was writing, but he was also in a band, and he would act, and he would, do shows. He like did a one-man show for a little while, and he wrote a novel, and he's always had his hands in, and wrote a comic strip. He's always had his hands in all sorts of stuff, which is why his current job, I think, he's so well suited for. But yeah, we all kind of took our own path and landed at, oh, we like this business of creating, performing, sometimes even just facilitating stories. And it's been an interesting and cool ride.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing. Hello, over here.
Hello, Daniel.
Hello.
Hey, Sean. My name's Cody, or you can call me Oliver Queen.
I'll call you Cody. Go on.
Sounds good. So, mine's kind of like a two-parter question. The first one is, who did you like playing better, Weasel or Calendar Man?
I enjoy Calendar Man because I'm vain and I like having my face on the screen. No, I don't know. I like to, they're both fun. Again, it's two totally different types of things. I don't look at it really as having a preference, but I like playing Calendar Man a great deal, even in that little tiny bit.
And who would you rather your brother bring back in the new DCEU, Calendar Man or Weasel?
Well, I think I can break some news here that Creature Commandos is coming out, the animated series Creature Commandos, and I will be returning as Beasel in Creature Commandos. So there's that.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you, Cody. Good to see you. Over here, hello.
I'm Kelly, and the question is, February 2023, Kraglin and the Guardians land in Stars Hollow.
Oh boy.
What is Kirk doing right now, and how does he react?
While you're thinking of this, out of curiosity, we have Gilmore Girls fans here. Love it.
I imagine how that would go is something like this. I think Kirk would see the spaceship coming, freak out, have a panic attack, scramble to find the town loner's bomb shelter, which must be, he must have some kind of bunker down there. And so Kirk's like, things are, you gotta let me into the bunker. Try to bribe him with everything he can. Fail, and then Kraglin will think that Kirk is suspicious and kill him.
Thank you.
Follow-up question, Sean. When you are, you know, out and about or perhaps at conventions, do you, which do you get recognized more for? The G of the G or GG? Gilmore Girls or Guardians? What do you
It varies depending on from city to city. You know, fortunately my career has gone well enough that now mostly I get people just saying, are you Sean Gunn, which is nice. But not specifying. But it's pretty close to 50-50. It depends on where I am. It's been more Guardians lately. For years it was more Gilmore Girls. And now I think it's more Guardians a little bit.
One follow-up question. Are there Gilmore Girls conventions?
They do a fan festival every year that I've been to one time. It seems like a lot of fun. But I can tell you, and some of you might already know this, the Gilmore Girls fans are rabid. They're an intense fan group, and I love them. They're the best. But they're really into it. They're really hardcore.
That's awesome. Thank you. Hello, over here.
Hi, my name is Maddie, and I have a two-part question. My first one is if you could do your best impression of Yondu's I'm Mary Poppins, y'all.
Oh, God. I'm Mary Poppins, y'all.
And my second part was, what was the thought process behind Rocket trying to take Bucky's arm? Like, my question basically is, how do you expect to get it from him if you were, if Rocket were ever to try to actually get it from him?
He got it. Didn't you see the Christmas special?
Yeah, I did.
How did he get it?
Yeah.
Well, that I can't tell you. That's proprietary information. But, you know, certainly he won when he saw it. He's like, Rocket loves gadgets. It's like his, you know, that's his thing. It's his favorite thing in the world. So that was a particularly, like, that's a cream of the crop gadget, right? So he's like, I can't have that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Hello, over here.
Hi, my name's Annika. My friend wanted to ask you what your favorite line was and, like, anything. Just, like, your favorite line.
That I've said?
Yeah.
Oh, boy. I can say this. My very favorite line for sure is in Guardians of the Galaxy 3, opening May 5th in theaters near you. that's a good question. I've never had that question.
Is there a...
Captain's Gotta Teach Stuff is really good. I'm gonna think about that, and I'll send it out. I'll try to put it out. But I right now I'm thinking Captain's Gotta Teach Stuff. Although there are lines that I said as Kirk that just pop into my head, like after 20 years, and I'm like, oh yeah, that was really funny. Anyway, that's the best I can do, I'm sorry.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Great question. How often do you, do you ever find yourself, you know, not only with, Gilmore Girls or with Guardians of the Galaxy, with all of the projects that you've worked on over the years, do you keep any sort of, mementos from filming, whether it be scripts or you know, a little costume piece, anything like that?
A few things. I have one, I have a Gilmore Girls script signed by, everybody, including Melissa McCarthy and the late Ed Herman, and that's a kind of a treasured memento. I used to keep my chair backs and stuff, but mostly I don't know. It's like there's always something. There's always some kind of poster or some kind of thing to commemorate stuff. But I don't steal things from set, if that's what you mean. So close.
Over here, hello.
Hi, my name is Miles, and my question is, what's the thought process behind the name Taserface?
Hi, Miles. I've never been able to figure that out, so if you can give me an answer, I would love one. It's got to take your face as a taser? It doesn't make sense, right? I don't know. He chose it for himself. He could have chosen anything. I guess he thought it sounded cool. Does it sound cool, Miles? Yeah, I agree.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, Sean. My name is PJ. Welcome to Vancouver, by the way.
Thank you.
Question, especially for the aspiring people who want to get in the entertainment industry. It's very easy to put our heroes on a pedestal, but they always seem more human when we see them fail. So can you talk a bit about, throughout your career, maybe some failure and how you overcame it?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, honestly, one of the things that was interesting about my career is that I didn't just suddenly make it. I very much took very small steps. I went to acting school, I did theater, I started doing commercials, I did enough commercials to move to LA, I did B-movies and small stuff, did one lines on, did a little bit of extra work here and there. Anyway, so, by the time I started really auditioning and I was starting to get recurring roles on TV shows, and then I started on Gilmore Girls, before I became a regular, I was like, oh, I'm killing it. Like, I made it, this is easy for me, and I'm gonna have this whole long, wonderful career. And then I became a regular on Gilmore Girls and got sort of complacent in that job, and years went on where I wasn't pursuing a ton of other work. I did some other stuff here and there, but mostly I was just doing the show and oh, and when the show's done, I'll go get on another show, right? And then 2007, the show ended a little earlier than I expected. And it was just I felt like casting directors had forgotten who I was. Gilmore Girls was a nice, modest hit for the CW, but it was not the phenomenon that it is now. That didn't happen until Netflix. And so I was I'd been on this show, but nobody knew what it was or who I was. I got less auditions after it was done than before it had started. And I just had a couple of years of thinking that I was gonna walk right back out there. And I did very little work, but I was very close to I had to sell my house. I had to do a lot of things, and it really wasn't until, and I was like, oh my God, I'm really not, I thought I'd made it, and I am not making it right now. And that's kind of when Guardians came out. And then the weird thing was, Guardians came along right when Netflix was getting huge, right when Gilmore Girls was getting huge on Netflix. And so all of a sudden it was things started to ramp up, and it took some time, and I was able to come back. That's a little, that middle period lull, I think it happens to a lot of people, but it's different from the beginning when you just can't get started, but it's a similar type of thing. And, um, And I think I'm a lot more, I'm grateful for it because I'm more grateful. I have a lot, I live my life with a lot more gratitude about the work that I have now and the movies that I'm doing and the connection that I'm able to have with fans, or like being able to come to a convention like this and have people want to come and see me. I was young, so it's not like I beat myself up for it, but I should have treated it with a little, like it was a little more special at the time. And I should have been probably working harder to like hone my craft and get more work and do those things back then. Anyway, that's a long answer, but I appreciate the question, and stick with it is the lesson.
I was gonna say the fine line between perseverance and keeping falling in love with what you're doing and honing the craft, I think is very important during the down times, I guess, right?
Yeah.
Thanks, Sean. Thank you.
Thank you, great question. Great answer, thank you. Hello, over here.
Hi, I'm Ben. I'm wondering what your favorite scene in the film was.
Which film?
Like Guardians of the Galaxy franchise.
That's the same question we had at the beginning. I love the 12% of a plan scene. It's like really, it's just, there's something kind of awesome about it that sort of, it's like if you were trying to get a loved one to watch the movie and they didn't want to, and you're like, all right, well just watch this one scene and then decide if you want to watch it. I think that's the one you'd show.
Great, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Hello, over here.
Hello, my name is Brad. My question is, do you have any desires or goals or dreams to play any DC characters and work with your brother again now that he's kind of taken over the next wave of the DC universe?
Well, it would be foolish of me to mention anything by name. The true answer is I don't ever have anything specific when it comes to working with my brother. Until I do. If I have a specific idea, hey, I've got an idea for this, I can always talk to him about it. But otherwise, I kind of trust him to let me know what he thinks I work well in. Like I said, I know I'm going to be doing Creature Commandos. I hope that there'll be other stuff that I'll be working on. I'm sure there will be. We've talked a little bit about a couple of things. But right now, I have no idea, and I'm sure he has no idea. Thanks.
Thank you. Hello, over here.
Hi, my name is Ben. My question is for Gilmore Girls. Who do you think Rory should have ended up with?
Again, the cameras are on. So,
I am firmly team Rory does not need a man to define her. My answer is no one.
Thank you.
What a great answer. That is, wow. Over here again.
Hey Sean, I'm Nathan. I was just wondering what your experience working on Lollipop Chainsaw was.
It was really fun. It was like, it went by like that. It was one day, many, many years ago, one day in a booth. My character is Swan, and he looks a little like Marilyn Manson or something. I just screamed into it. Had a hard time keeping my voice. I think I lost my voice like crazy at the end of that day. I wasn't ready for it, but yeah, it was fun.
Thanks.
Thank you. Hello, over here.
Hello, I'm Carol.
Hi.
Hey, I was wondering, is there an actor or an actress you'd like to appear in a buddy film with?
Oh gosh, good question. I think it would be fun to do that with Dave Bautista.
Love Batista.
I like the idea of doing a buddy movie. I'll have to think about that one. Tell my agent.
Awesome. Thank you. Hello over here.
Hi. Welcome to Vancouver. I love you, Guardians of the Galaxy.
Thank you.
And I'd like to ask, what's your favorite Marvel character?
Kraglin?
Your favorite Marvel character.
Other than Kraglin, maybe? Kraglin.
Right? Was I supposed to give a different answer? I don't know. What were you expecting?
Any other one?
Rocket?
There we go.
Yeah. Now, before we jump over here, I'm curious, Sean, you mentioned earlier that you're not necessarily a kickball.
I think I'd be a much bigger gamer if I was like 5 or 6 years younger or 5 or 6 years older. There's certain graphic novels I love, but I really like movies.
That's awesome.
Television.
We love movies, we love TV, yeah. We're glad you're part of it. We have time for a few more questions, which I'm very glad to see we have some more folks up here. Let's jump over here.
Hi, my name is Phil. I was wondering, do you have a specific process for creating the voice of a character?
It's just part of the overall character work that I do when I get a character. You know, when I get a role, I have a sort of a holistic process to trying to get to the place where I can think in character. Like, I feel like when you know, it's not just when you say what the character says. It's when you know what the character isn't saying. Is you're a lot closer to figuring out who they are than when you know what they are saying. What they choose not to say is often really revealing. So you're like sort of thinking in character. And in somewhere on the journey in getting there, the voice comes out.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, sure. Good question.
Thank you. Perfect. I think we should have enough time to get to all of our questions that are currently up. So here we go.
Hi, Sean. I was wondering if there's any like role you'd like to pursue in the future, like a role that's special to you that you'd like to do in the future.
One thing I've learned in my, 25 years now as an actor is that as soon as you hope for something, you're going to get something else. So it's like, I don't think about that too much. But I do know that I look forward to a part of my career where I did this TV show, The Terminalist, with Chris Pratt last year, and I really enjoyed the character that I played, partially because he was just a human who was more my age, and the role wasn't entirely goofy, and like it was a little bit more of a serious role, and like I love comedy, so I'll always do that too, but I look forward to sort of letting the roles age with me, you know? And so that's what I want, is roles that continue to like feel like who I am now and not who I was 5 or 10 or 15 years ago.
That's great.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you. Over here, Heather.
Hi, my name is Sarah. You mentioned a little earlier that Chris Pratt was a little bit of a jokester on the set of Guardians of the Galaxy.
That's correct.
I've heard of a couple other interviews with other people who have worked with him that is a very nice person, everything. Would you say that that's true, and that Chris Pratt is as nice as everybody says he is?
He's the best.
Yeah?
Yeah. I had a bunch of funny answers to give, but we got a long one here. But no, Chris is the absolute most wonderful dude you could imagine. And it shows on sets. A lot of times movie sets and TV sets will sort of take on the persona of number one on the call sheet a little bit, where they're, if you have somebody who's difficult to talk to and who is not very welcoming or open, you can have sets that are hard places to work. And the Guardians set is an absolutely wonderful place to work. And Chris pays some part in that, as does everyone, my brother and everyone. But yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you. All right, now we have 5 more questions, which means it's now time for the lightning round.
Uh-oh.
So basically, we're gonna try and keep these questions a little bit tight, and we'll get some answers from Sean, starting over here.
Hi, my name is Jordana, and I was just wondering if there's any advice that you'd give for someone starting out in the industry, like something to look for either in an agent or how to network properly.
Networking for the most part is overrated. It's not really a big, it's like, you know, people want to give you jobs when they see your work, not when they meet you at a party. And so like my biggest advice is finish what you start.
because you can't move on to the next thing until you're finished with the thing before it. And make your own stuff. Find people that are like-minded creatively and work on projects together and make things. And people will be attracted by that, and that will bring you to representation.
Awesome, thank you so much.
Yeah, you got it.
Thank you. Over here.
Hi, my name's Kira, and I was just wondering, what's one of your favorite moments from the Gilmore Girls set?
My very favorite moment was singing "Do You Love Me" in the Fiddler on the Roof episode. That is like me with my terrible voice and an 8-year-old girl with a beautiful voice, with Luke and Lorelai on the wings staring at each other. It's like the perfect moment of like, it's funny and weird and absurd and tender and like everything all at once. That's my favorite.
Thank you.
You got it.
Thank you. Over here.
Hi, Sean.
Hi.
Okay, so what's the biggest roadblock or hurdle you ever had in your lifetime?
I think I sort of touched on this earlier when I was answering about difficulties, but it's like my biggest roadblock has been thinking that things are going to be easier than they are. You know, thinking that things come naturally and come easy, and that things would sort of fall into place. I've learned much more that you work hard for things, and then you're more grateful for them, and then you have peace of mind.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Great reminder. Second to last question.
Hi, my name is Sharon, and my question is, do you think Taylor and Luke from Gilmore Girls should have ended their feud at the end of the show?
They
ended and became friends at the end.
Oh, and then I don't think that's going to last for very long, personally. I think they were probably back at it the following week.
Thank you. And last but definitely not least, hello.
Hello, Sean. I just like to say I am heartfelt to thank you for accepting the role on Suicide Squad as the Weasel. when you lit the screen for that scene, I went myself in the theater.
Congratulations.
Wonderful. And of course, on that very lovely note, we of course wish not only you, Sean, have a lovely day, but all of you. Remember, Fan Expo is just getting started. Lots more fun to be had, and we kick things off by having fun with Sean Gunn.
Thank you, Sean. Thank you, everybody. It's nice to be here.
Okay. Hi. My name is Lovely going.